So, I recently decided to watch the new Netflix movie Bird Box, and I probably wouldn't have watched it on my own without everybody and their mom telling me about it and telling me to watch it. There are so many memes of this movie going around that people thought Netflix was creating fake Twitter accounts to make memes for their new movie. This turned out not to be true, by the way, but it just goes to show you how many people watched this fucking movie. So is it good or bad? Well, it's like in the middle somewhere. I'm not really sure where yet. There are people saying it's amazing, and there's people saying it's absolute crap, and both people are kind of exaggerating a little bit. To me, it honestly felt like an above-average episode of a sci-fi show, like an extended Twilight Zone episode or something like that. Because the best things about this movie are the premise and the acting. There are some really good actors in this movie, and some of them show up just to die. Some people have compared this movie to A Quiet Place and The Happening, and yeah, it's got similarities in the premise, but the presentation is completely different. For instance, A Quiet Place is actually shot kinda well, and Bird Box looks like a TV movie for some reason. However, both movies are similar in one aspect, and it's not really a good one. They will both make you question the logic of the movie. In A Quiet Place, I kept saying to myself, okay, but hold on a second. And by the end of this movie, I was saying the exact same thing. Now, in a high-concept sci-fi horror movie, I try to suspend my disbelief, because you kinda have to. However, I have my limits. So I'm gonna talk about what works in this movie and what doesn't work. And the list of things that don't work is a little long, but that doesn't mean I didn't like the movie, I just think that the problems need to be addressed. But since I'm trying to be nicer, let's talk about the good things first. So the first good thing I like about this movie is the premise. The premise of this movie is honestly what kept me watching. The idea here is that Earth is being overrun by some kind of eldritch Lovecraftian creatures or demons or whatever. And if you look at them, you go crazy and you kill yourself. Now I'm a sucker for wacky premises like this, so when I started watching the movie, I realized what it's about and I'm like, hey, neat. How creative. I mean, I guess it's based on a book, so the person who made that kind of came up with the idea, so they get the credit for that one. The one thing this movie is consistent with is the rules that the creatures follow. If you look at the creatures, you die, period. The movie establishes early on that you can't cheat the system. If you look at them, you're donezo. Except for the select few people who look at them and become fanatical worshippers and are kind of recruited by the monster demon thingies. Now, I thought this was a cool idea, and it added another layer to the premise that I wasn't expecting, because if it was just about these floating Cthulhu monsters that can't touch you and just have to wait around and hope that you look at them, I don't really think that would have been enough to carry the movie. However, personally, if I could make one itsy-bitsy teeny little change, it would be not to make people kill themselves after seeing the monsters. Honestly, the only reason is because in The Happening, when people kill themselves, it's kind of the funniest thing ever. And I can't stop thinking about it when I watch this movie. Also, I think it would just be cool if in true Lovecraft fashion, you just die from seeing the creatures. Like, your brain just can't process this otherworldly horror, and you just die. I don't know, it's just my personal preference, who cares what I think. I also really, really like that you never really see the creatures, because it helps you build the illusion and horror in your mind. Like, damn, these things must be really ugly, huh? However, I don't like that this one guy just draws them later in the movie because it seriously looks like bad video game concept art. I really didn't want to know what they look like, but you had to show me, huh? The next thing I liked in this movie is the acting. The acting is really good, and honestly, it's good enough to trick you into listening to what would normally be pretty weird writing.
Are you puking?
Just go to the car.
He's a junkie.
In this movie, the script is either dumb or pretty good, and the acting is always on point. So whenever characters are saying something, even if it's something that's kind of dumb or doesn't matter, you don't really care because you believe it. These actors are taking this movie pretty fucking seriously. Most notably, Sandra Bullock is really good and incredibly believable as her character, to the point where I kind of just wish the movie was about her, because I just like her way better than everybody else. And also the fact that the other characters are really fucking annoying. And now we get to the first thing that I don't like about this movie. The characters are really fucking annoying. I get that this is a post-apocalyptic movie, so the characters might not really be in the best mood, but holy shit, everybody in this movie is really stupid. First, we have the guy from Mr. Robot, who comes up with this ridiculous plan to look at the creatures with a security camera. Now, like I mentioned before, I kind of give this a pass because it shows the audience that there are no loopholes here. It's very important for the narrative of the story that something like this happens. But what I don't like is the character's reasoning for coming up with this plan. He makes it seem like he's gonna look at them through like a filter or something. Like, I thought maybe we were gonna do like an infrared camera, cause maybe that would work. I didn't think he was just gonna look at them with a normal camera. Like, yeah, no shit, that wasn't gonna work. What's also really stupid is that they just kinda tie him to a chair and then they leave the room and they fuck around while he's doing this incredibly dangerous job. You don't think it would have been a good idea for someone to stay in there with him? Like, they don't have to look at the screen. Just stay there in case something happens. Anyway, the next characters that we have are Machine Gun Kelly and Cop Girl. They have a couple lines, and then they leave the movie forever. I don't know, we didn't really need them to be in the movie, but that's okay. And then we have Old Woman, who has no character, and then she dies. I don't know, we didn't really need her to be in the movie either, but that's okay. The comic relief character from Get Out plays the comic relief character in this movie, and he honestly ruins the tone of the first, like, 45 minutes of the film for me. When he shows up, I was like, oh, okay, I guess I just won't take this movie very seriously then. The lighthearted moments in this movie really don't fit, and there are times when this movie doesn't really feel as dire and serious as it should.
Making the end of the world great again! Yo!
Next we have the guy from Moonlight, who isn't actually the worst character, and I kinda like him, but for some reason he has this strange mysterious disorder where he's very trusting of people he's never met before. And he keeps opening doors to very obviously dangerous situations.
What?
I'm gonna open the door. I have to open the door.
Don't open the goddamn
door. I'm gonna open the door.
What is it with you and doors? This man is too trusting, and it almost always gets someone killed. In fact, in this scene, he should have probably opened the door to let John Malkovich out so he could help him fight the crazy man, but he doesn't do it. What is it with you and doors? The next characters we have are Boy and Girl. And I'm not making a joke this time, that's actually their names. Now, I don't understand the concept behind naming them Boy and Girl. I get that you don't want to get too emotionally attached to them, but I think it would cause a lot less confusion if you just gave them real names. I don't know, like, imagine a scenario where you guys maybe get separated and you need to get their attention, but they can't hear you. I don't know, it'd just be really nice if you had, like, a name for them, but... Now, obviously, these kids are the worst actors in the movie, but that's not really their fault, because they're kids, and they're put next to Sandra Bullock and John Malkovich.
The other children in the world?
You're doing great, sweetie. Now, I got other problems with these characters, and I'll talk about that later, so we're gonna move on. Lastly on my list of dumbass characters, we have fucking Olympia. I think I speak for everyone when I say that I could not wait for this character to die.
Shut up, Olympia!
Not only does she cause the deaths of over half of our characters, but the movie also kind of wants us to like her. And I don't really agree with that. Sandra Bullock has no reason to like this character, but she ends up kind of thinking fondly of her at multiple points in the movie. Sandra Bullock's whole character is that she doesn't really fuck around with people that she doesn't like, and she would not like this person. I don't care if it's the apocalypse.
Your name is Olympia, named after the sweetest girl I ever met.
Shut up, Olympia!
However, John Malkovich doesn't like her, and that's why I like him, because his whole character is that he hates all the other characters.
You let a stranger
in
the house?
He was
terrified. Are you a simpleton?
And that's how I feel too. So anyway, this movie is set during two time periods, the flashback, which is the time leading up to and directly after the apocalypse, and the current timeline, the present day, which shows Sandra Bullock's life 5 years after the apocalypse. Now, I went into this movie completely blind. Get it? And I knew absolutely nothing about the premise. So when the movie starts with this mystery and then flashes back to the past, I was on board. I thought it was kind of cool to have a quick flashback to show everything going to shit and show us how the characters ended up in this situation. However, I thought that right after this chaos, we would cut back to the original timeline and just, you know, keep going with that. But then I saw John Malkovich, and I realized he's too expensive to be around for less than a few minutes. And then I saw a house full of fucking doofuses, and I realized that this is gonna be half of the movie. And that's honestly one of the biggest problems I have with this movie. The two timelines just don't work for me. I mean, I guess technically it's one timeline, but it has different points on the time. You get what I mean. I didn't realize this until I watched the movie again, but the movie feels really disjointed because of these two separate stories that are being told. I think everybody would agree that the theme of this movie is Sandra Bullock becoming a mother. And this theme is hinted at slightly a few times in the flashback, but not really that much. Whereas in the present time, it's basically the whole story. This movie kind of just feels like events are happening to the characters and they're just reacting to them. And then at the very end, we're throwing in a theme of motherhood. There's a lot of parts of this movie where there's a distinct lack of focus. The first thing we see in this movie is that Sandra Bullock and these kids are all by themselves. So we already know everybody's gonna die, which means that we don't really have any emotional impact when they do die. It's hard to get too attached to these people when we already are told from the beginning that they're all screwed. Because as it is, I was just left not really feeling connected to anyone but Sandra Bullock because I knew what was going to happen to them. You have to first focus on the story you're trying to tell, and then make sure that story is being told well. The story here is apparently about motherhood, and it's ignored for a good chunk of the movie. I honestly think the movie should have just been the present day and maybe a little bit of flashback, because that should be the more interesting story, this journey that the characters are going on. I would have been fine with a full-on post-apocalyptic movie about a mom getting her kids to safety without being able to see. That's actually pretty creative, and I would have been into it. However, these two kids don't really get any character development until the very end of the movie. I mean, tell me the difference between boy and girl. You can't. They're the same person. Like, apparently girl doesn't really like Sandra Bullock that much. And we only know that because boy told us. I don't know, maybe I'm asking too much of this movie. But these are some of our main characters, so I really don't think I am. Make the movie about her and the two kids, give the kids fucking personalities, and explain the premise over time. These characters could have gone on a more meaningful adventure instead of just a trip down the river. Anyway, once the flashback catches up to the present day, we start to see the movie really lose its focus. Now I know most of this video has been me railing on this movie, but I was actually enjoying it up to this point, because it's pretty good at keeping your attention. But this is where I went from enjoying the movie to thinking that there's probably some bigger problems than I thought. Now up to this point, our characters haven't really had anything to do outside. They've mostly been in a house. I will suspend my disbelief when it comes to them driving to the supermarket without seeing. This is a creative solution to a problem, and I wish the movie had more of this. Later on in the movie, there's no more cute, creative ideas. This is kind of the extent of it. There's a part in the movie where we see Sandra Bullock teaching the kids how to, like, navigate with the sound of these rocks. And I thought this was a cool idea. I thought they were gonna do this later on, and they never do this again. Now, when Sandra Bullock is riding on a little boat with these kids with a blindfold on, I understand how this can make sense because it's a straight line. You can't mess it up. I'm totally sold on everything I've seen so far. However, all of the logic goes completely out the window once our characters get to the rapids. So our heroes are going down the river to reach this safe haven that they've heard about, but they were warned about the rapids. Now our main character decides to just risk it all and go in blind into the rapids, and I thought this was a very good character defining moment. And I really like this scene where she kinda almost decides to sacrifice Olympia's baby, but decides not to because she's growing as a character and growing into the role of a mother. You know, the theme of the movie that we've kind of ignored up until this point. So anyway, they crash their boat because, duh, they can't see. And all three of them survive and they meet up with each other without being able to see. And this is where I started to get that feeling again. The feeling that this movie's not making no sense. Number one, I know she didn't teach these kids how to swim. She literally could not have done that at any point in their short lives. So they should just be dead. The two kids, they would definitely be dead in this situation. Two, they can't fucking see. Have you tried to swim without seeing? Try doing it in dangerous waters with deadly rocks and shit. Okay, now imagine if you were also never taught how to swim. And number three, the birds that they keep in a little cardboard box also survived. Honestly, I draw the line at the birds. That is just a little too unreasonable. Now, I didn't read the book, but someone told me in the book apparently she does look herself instead of getting one of the kids to do it. And I think that would have been a much more interesting and exciting climax to the movie. Like, the whole movie she's spending all this time trying not to take her blindfold off, and she has to do it to save her kids. I think that would have been pretty fucking cool. Because after this point, the movie really doesn't have anything to keep us watching. Our characters have just crashed their boat, and now they're just gonna walk to their destination, despite the fact that they've never been here before. And the fact that they can't fucking see. At every moment up to this point, them not being able to see was very understandable. They got around through other things. They used little strings to help them navigate. It is officially too ridiculous for me to believe that they can find their way through a forest that they've never been in while blind and being chased by fucking Cthulhu. They claim that they can follow the sounds of the birds to get to the sanctuary, but the birds act like a damn fool when the monsters are around, so they can't actually hear where the birds are coming from. Yet somehow through all this shit, they make it to their destination in record time. They only trip twice, and they don't really bump into anything. Now, this might sound like a silly nitpick, but this is what the whole movie's based on. If our characters really don't have any problem navigating without being able to see, then this premise doesn't really work, does it? Now, I personally have walked around a lot of forests, and I've tripped and bumped into things while I had use of all three of my eyes. This dangerous trip ends up being a little too easy for my liking. And when I say easy, I'm not just talking about the fact that they haven't tripped or anything, I'm also talking about emotionally. This is the climax of the movie, and it's mostly our characters running away from something that can't actually hurt them. There's technically no threat in this scene whatsoever. The creatures can only ask them politely to take their blindfolds off. The journey itself isn't dangerous anymore because they're not lost, and the creature can't hurt them. So the climax is just them walking to the sanctuary. So yeah, they make it safely, and they meet up at this safe haven, and they live happily ever after. That was the climax of the movie. It kind of makes the ending as a whole a little whack, and honestly made me reevaluate my feelings that I had for this movie. This ending kind of left a bad taste in my mouth, and while I liked everything leading up to this, I don't know. This kind of made me think about things a little differently. The thing is, like I said, I didn't originally dislike this movie while I was watching it. I was having an okay time. I didn't think it was anything spectacular, but I thought the potential was there. However, afterwards, I started thinking about it a lot, and I ended up liking the movie less and less. Because I like parts of it a lot, but other parts kind of ruin the things that I liked. And while I did enjoy making fun of this movie like I always do, I think there's at least some value to this film. We're currently in an age where creative horror movies are becoming pretty prevalent, and some are really good, and others have potential that they don't always fully live up to. Luckily, this movie does still manage to show some fun ideas and be interesting for most of the runtime. I can safely say that I at least was never bored watching it. And yeah, most of this review was negative, but I think in this endless sea of shit, this movie could have definitely been worse. So as a final verdict, do I like Bird Box? I'm still not really sure. What I am trying to say is that it's definitely better than Aquaman. Okay, bye!